I was performing and there was two people in the audience, and in the middle of my set they decided to leave.
I just don't like sex as much.
Yeah, I have no sex experience. That's like, I have some now.
I'm the king of awkward in a lot of situations. So a lot of times,
hello I would go against you right now.
Currently, I'm spending immense amount of time cleaning my flatmate's cat's piss.
Oh shit!
From my things.
Do you like cats?
Yeah, I mean, I was thrusted upon with a cat when he got it, and then I had to
thrusted
upon? Like, he just got it one day.
Okay.
And then I was like, cool, we have a cat now. So yeah, they chill.
They're good. Like, you feel like with cats, I feel like you have to earn their respect or love.
That I don't understand.
No.
Come on, man. I let you stay in my house.
That's not good enough for them. They're just like... Well, with dogs, you know...
Yeah, I grew up with a dog. So I'm used to people being thankful.
Here's the thing I like about cats than dogs is that they stay in their own space, unlike dogs.
Yeah.
The dogs are always in your face, licking you somewhere.
Yeah.
And just inside you.
What?
Yeah.
What kind of dogs do you
have? Bro, it's just another flatmate of mine once had a dog. So
yeah, dogs, their boundaries are not that. I mean, can you train them well enough so that they know when to come around you?
So my dog was a little special. If I give him, I used to give him too much attention. So he didn't really bother me that much.
Yeah,
I used to bother him more than he used to bother me.
The problem with them is when they're puppies, you can't help but give them that much love and attention. Like, you look at them, you can't stay. Then that spoils them.
Yes.
And then that stays.
Yes.
Now, the girl I'm dating, like, going to her house and doing shit is a task. Like, the dog wants to join in. Because I don't think they understand what's going on. They just want, they like, oh, even I want to play.
The dog understands. He just does not like to be a cuck, dude.
Yeah, probably. He doesn't look away, bro.
He wants to enjoy as a spectator.
Yeah.
That's what.
Well, then I like cats because then you feel like you have to put in effort.
Mm-hmm.
Dogs, you kick them. Like, the dogs who get abused also, they still go to their owner and,
they
give them love. But with cats, it's like, no, you have to earn that respect. Then maybe...
Yeah.
So it's the game that you like, not the cat.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You're in it for
the
cheese.
I like the cheese, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
I still remember when he got the cat... So for the first week, I couldn't really pet her.
Yeah.
So what we had to do is we had to train her to my smell. So I used to constantly give her my hand and then she'd smell it. And then she'd look away. Just walk off.
Nah, aaj nahi pasand.
Like, dude, I adrak
kam hai thoda.
So yeah, over a period of time, then she got used to it. Then she peed on my beanbag then.
Oh, that was your symbol of love.
Yeah.
That's really cool.
That's how she showed that she accepts me in her life now.
By peeing on your bean.
Yeah.
Yeah. I knew a girl like that. Oh, I'm kidding. So you're dealing with cats right now.
Yeah.
And what about you? What are
you
up to?
Dealing with just... I don't know, man. I really want to do something. I can't figure out what it is. I want to put out some video
content.
But I can't even do live shows.
Yeah.
And that sucks.
Yeah. Well, with content, right now it's so tricky because you don't want to be a sellout also. Posting.
What's
like
the problem
trends.
In being a sellout?
There's no problem. If you're okay with it, do it, man. Like, if these... I don't want to name comics, but then if shaking your ass is going to help you sell more tickets, do it. Why the fuck not?
I would do it if I had an ass.
No, but then as an artist, you feel also, I should do something new, something unique. Or you don't, I don't know. But
yeah, I've been trying to explore it. Just don't know what. It's like randomly things will work.
Yeah, I have kind of figured out what works and what doesn't work. Like, it's so sad that it's the first 2 seconds of anything that you post on Instagram is it's make it or break it.
Oh,
like,
yeah,
your first 2 seconds,
like, oh yeah.
Now when I post clips also from the podcast, at the start I posted some clips, some worked, some didn't work, but now I consciously edit it in a way, like every reel starts with, oh, do you guys know, or have you ever felt like, so once I say that, people are like, huh, what is he feeling like, let me see the rest.
Yeah.
And that retention itself, no, it, I don't know, it really helps with the algorithm.
It makes a lot of difference. I still remember when we used to upload YouTube videos. So like they used to show this in the YouTube studio, they show the graph of how much people are engaging with the video, right?
Yeah.
So the first few minutes of the video were boom, like everybody was watching it. But after one point in time, it just slumped.
Yeah.
And wherever you read about, okay, how do I improve this, you know, watch ratio that people are constantly watching through my whole... There's no answer for it. There's just like, it'll always drop. So that initial hook has to be so good that it gets that person like, okay, this is what I want to waste my time or use my time in 10 minutes.
You're constantly fighting for attention when you're putting content out with other people.
Yeah.
Where everyone's trying to get your attention. Yeah.
One thing I actually learned the hard way is that this is something that doesn't come naturally to me, even though I studied design, but I just used to mess up the lighting and the sound and everything. I used to look like some kidnapped person in a shady room trying to do comedy so that they will let them out. But yeah, I feel like now it's a little better.
Yeah, I mean, now what do you need, bro? You need a ring light.
Yes.
That's all, right? As a content creator, all you need is a ring light.
Yeah.
And a decent camera.
Yeah, what I hate about ring lights is that the fact that when some people put the ring light right in front of their face and then they put the camera, so you can see the ring in their eyes.
Yeah, yeah.
So why?
And if you're wearing glasses, though, it's even worse.
Yeah, it's even worse.
Yeah, like two. Look like a fucking bug.
It's like a bug, dude. So that's the most annoying part of having a ring light, in my opinion.
Yeah, but there. Who came up? Who do you think came up with a ring light? They were like, let's take a light and make it round.
Yeah, man. Why is it round?
I don't know. It would have been a square also. Like you can put
like these ones that we made at home.
Huh.
These were like we never
you
thought.
Made this
we...
at home?
Yeah, it's just a cardboard box with like LED bulbs in it.
Damn, bro. Were you in design?
No.
Oh.
No.
He's doing better than us, man.
he made it.
Oh, nice.
Yeah, I only gave him credit because he'll ask me later on.
But this is a neat job, dude.
Yeah, I always wanted to do a podcast, but audio is just, it's good if you're known or like you're talking about something specific. Like I listen to a lot of audio podcasts, but if they're like niche, if it's a history podcast or like something where I'm learning, but if I'm only watching it for fun, like this is primarily a comedy podcast, even with other people when I do it, we're just talking shit mainly. So I was like, you need to look at people when they're talking shit. You need to look at my reaction or your reaction when I say something. So you're like, let's put it together.
Otherwise it would be like that. You remember that one corporate show we had done? Not corporate show, so some project that we had done.
Yeah.
Where they wanted us to do something on Zoom where we were talking to each other. It was like a podcast kind of a thing.
With an audience?
No audience.
So it was a pre-recorded podcast that we did. Okay. And it aired for like what, 3 minutes, 2 minutes?
It aired. I don't know what happened to it. But so apparently there was some college.
Yeah.
Blah, blah,
it was
college.
Some travel related college.
Okay.
What they did, we don't know.
They want a travel related podcast to put on their website.
And they wanted it to be like funny, witty.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But the thing was that he was in Kolkata. We did it with another comedian, Anamika. She was in Chennai.
Yeah.
Not Chennai, Cochin. Sorry.
How do you not know? Man.
I keep making this mistake. But she was in Cochin. So we had to do it on Zoom and that was so bad.
So what? You guys got to record it and then you could have seen it, no? Okay, if it's... good enough.
We saw it, but we had to submit it the next day. So we're like, good enough.
Good, whatever. Our first takes were the best takes ever.
So what, they aired in front of an audience or what did they
do? So it was sort of like a seminar that they were doing. So we did, I think we did a sketch also with it.
Yes.
Two sketch, one sketch.
We did an opening sketch and closing sketch.
And in the middle, we put the podcast.
Yes.
Yeah.
So, yeah, it was quite bad, but it was okay.
It's not bad. I mean, yeah, it was whatever. They paid us.
Yeah, they paid us. That's what matters.
So let's I want to talk about how now.
Wait, one second. What have you been up to?
Yeah, man.
You asked us. Now, what have you been up to?
Me, I've been working on this. I've been streaming a little.
Oh,
when
nice.
I play games, so I was like, might as well.
What are you playing?
I've been streaming FIFA. Because
okay.
You can get a friend along and play. Then we play this game called A Way Out. It's like a co-op prison break game.
Ooh.
Yeah. Yeah, but that's just for fun. I've been working on this only.
Right.
How did this start? How did the idea?
The podcast.
Yep.
I always wanted to do one, and I spoke to Tarang before you came. I wanted to start open micing like last year.
Yeah.
And I booked my first slot, and then COVID hit that weekend.
Oh.
Yeah. Then once stuff opened, I booked my first slot, and I got COVID, so I couldn't do it for 2-3 weeks. Then I finally did one. And then stuff shut down again.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. So I eventually want to try doing stand-up.
Yeah.
And then I was like, a podcast is a good... I don't know. It's practice.
Somewhere. Halfway there.
Yeah, it's there. I'm used to talking on the mic now. Like, the first open mic, I was not nervous at all.
Yeah.
I was like,
that's good.
I do this all the time.
Yeah, that's nice.
Except there's people staring at me now. Yeah. I wanted to ask you guys... Like here in Pune, you guys have been doing comedy for a while. Both of you are what, primarily English, your material, or?
Yep.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Yep.
So do you guys, is it like a bit of a, I don't know, like some words that I use, I don't think people knew the meanings of them. Like I said simp and no one knew what I was talking about. No one knew what a simp was.
Simp people know, I guess, right?
Maybe that crowd didn't.
Yeah. First place, it's also like a very Gen Z millennial lingo, which not a lot of people might know of.
Yeah, so then probably once you're like more popular and bigger, then the crowd that comes knows your lingo, right? But then at an open mic, you don't know who's going to come.
It's actually, I realized that most people know, it's just that...
Your joke sucked.
Yeah.
Because if you really like... I've been in multiple times where in my own head I would be thinking like, oh, maybe, you know, I'm using all these words that are not. And then I would do a joke that is equally wordy that would get a laugh. Yeah. Like, oh, no, it's just a joke.
Fair enough. But your material is it's all clean, right?
Yeah.
I don't think you cuss also in your...
No, I don't.
You don't, right?
At least not on purpose.
Yeah, in the show that I watched, you cussed like 0 times, but then you did something which wasn't a joke and you were like, oh, fuck. I was like, oh, that was the only part.
I remember the first time I'd ever cussed on stage, I apologized. It was at Nukkad. I was doing a gig, okay?
Yeah.
It was going well. I was fully in the mood of it, okay? And I did some joke, new joke. And I at the end the punchline I said some truth, and everybody laughed. And then suddenly I was like, no, I'm sorry.
But they laughed at the chutia or the joke?
That is why I said sorry.
Okay.
Because I'm sure they laughed at chutia because the joke didn't work out.
Yeah, I also think if you say chutia and all like you, that those are free laughs. But then I saw people do jokes which were super like loaded with galis and like no laughs. I was like, maybe it's not that easy.
It's a skill to use the galis also.
Yeah. What about you? Your material? I don't think it's clean.
It's not that clean. Like, I mean... Is it clean? I don't think it's clean.
It's a little dusty.
Like you've not cleaned that shelf for like a week maybe.
Yeah.
But yeah, I abuse on stage from time to time. I try not to. But
Do you do like sexual material also?
Yeah, I do have bits about relationships and things like that. So because of that, there are segues into it.
Yeah.
It's not like I'll just do dick jokes for like
10
minutes when I'm on stage.
Yeah.
I'm not there.
Is there some pullback if you've ever done like a dick joke? Like, does the crowd pull back a little here?
Sometimes not. It's a very mixed response.
Depends on where you are also.
Yeah.
It's like a bar audience, they're like, yeah, come on, man, dick joke.
Yeah. Like, if like this is what I have seen personally, if it's a bar, the more, how do you put it? When you are very provocative in a bar, it works a lot more because everybody's in that drinking state, right?
I struggle in a bar.
Yeah.
unless I really, really dance.
Which you do normally also.
But I really have to put up a dance with the bar people because my words are not being funny.
Yeah, I can see how it would, like in a bar, it'll be difficult. to, because like if you're talking about a line is not a line in a bar, and someone's like taking shots and they're like, man, this is like the last thing I wanted to talk about is geometry. Yeah.
You're existential about weird things in your
Yeah, specific things.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I don't think people want to enjoy that much.
They want a drink.
Why should a line be a rectangle?
The guy's all pissed off now. He's fighting with his wife.
He said line is a rectangle.
Oh man, but there aren't enough bar gigs in Pune.
Oh,
there
I
used
don't
to be.
Yeah. You
be.
Always have once a month, one will pop up.
Hmm.
And
then we'll only say, let's not do here, please.
Yeah. So this is how a bar gig always works in Pune. Some bar will contact a comic and be like, hey, I want to put up a show. Then the comic will contact few other comics because he doesn't want to take the hit of a bar gig alone.
Yeah.
So,
and because of material.
Fuck the material. No, that it's okay. I mean,
I have like, I won't take a one
that's
hour.
That's a you problem.
Okay, bar gig.
Go on.
So until the day before the gig, everybody's like, dude, let's scan this, let's not do this. And then finally the morning of that gig, everybody like, oh, hey, I don't have a spot.
Yeah.
So might as well, let's just go to the gig.
Yeah.
And then you go there and then there is no audience. So you first wait half an hour for people to filter in.
Yeah.
Then the guy has to tell people, oh, please go sit there. We have organized for some comedy for you.
Yeah.
Comedy.
And then still people don't come. So he gets a bunch of his friends who are sitting in the back smoking.
And they're already not in the mood.
Yeah.
The thing with bar gigs is the audience didn't come for the show.
Yeah.
They just
came
to just chill out and some guy started talking.
So you have to be really good.
Yeah.
To get them to.
You have to be really good. Yeah. Also, you have to have good banter.
Hmm.
That's what, because they're drinking, right? They want to do banter at that point
in
time with their friends. Now, the idea is that how are you able to add yourself in that banter?
Yeah. Be a part of the group.
Yeah. Sort of like that. I still remember the first ever open mic I did was at a bar gig.
Hmm.
It was at Replay Baner. I think that place is now shut down. Yeah.
It was a sports bar.
Yeah.
I've never been there.
Yeah. So it was my first ever open mic I had ever done. And it was an open mic, as in like anybody could come.
Oh,
so it was a music, poetry.
My first open mic was an open mic.
Yeah, those are the worst.
Yeah.
Those are the great, I used to kill them.
So what they decided to do was they decided to start with the musical acts.
Okay.
Now a musical act goes with a bar, right? Like, you know, he's singing Arijit Singh songs. The other guy's sad. It's nice. It works. Suddenly, I still remember, I think it was Akash Gaurav Singh's first gig also.
Oh.
So he went up on stage and then people got pissed.
Hmm.
Huh?
And
he's pretty.
Yeah, dude, there's just the fact that they had to cut down the music and then the comic who was talking on stage. So they got pissed.
Yeah.
And then they started heckling from the back. And they were damn drunk. This was at about 11:30 in the night. Now we're going up on stage. So Akash, he avoided them. He continued talking. And after one point of time, this guy got up and he just came to the stage and snatched the mic from him.
What? Oh. Audience member?
Yeah.
This was your
first mic, yes.
Yeah.
I realized the trauma.
So after that, the bouncers had to get involved. The mic had to be paused for like 10 minutes. Everybody took a smoke break.
That's all. They took a smoke break.
Everybody still wants to do their jokes. And I had come all the way from Loni to to Baner.
Yeah, yeah.
So I also wanted to try some jokes.
That was your first mic ever.
Yeah.
Great. That was a good place to start though.
A good benchmark.
Like you've gone through that. Now you're like, okay, I'm ready for.
Yeah. I mean, I didn't do comedy for 6 months after that.
Therapy was expensive. But
so tell me, who came on stage?
And then what did he do?
Who was the comedian? Akash? Oh yeah, I've seen him.
What's the worst? Is that the worst open mic you've been to?
No.
How
I was performing worse? And there was two people in the audience. And in the middle of my set, they decided to leave.
Both of them?
Yeah.
Loft.
I think, yeah. I don't remember.
It's the only place this can happen.
So, yeah. They just, so you're doing jokes and there's nobody in the audience, so you're looking at them and then in the middle they just look at each other like this, look at you again, and they slowly start to get up.
Yeah.
And you know, they think you can't notice them. But
what
they,
sucks is they're trying to be kind by going slowly.
You should have followed them. Sir, do you know about coconut trees?
They're just prolonging the pain by going slowly. Just leave, man. But yeah, that isn't that worse than bombing though? Like,
yeah, I mean, it's a worse because then there is no audience to bomb in front of.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah.
Right.
Well, how do you like? What's the how do you pull crowd? Like, if, for me, it's like if I ever want to do one, and then I call all my friends, and they'll show up also. They're nice people. They'll 10, 15 people. I'll find somehow and get. But then I don't know if I'm doing well, right? Because they'll laugh.
See the.
Firstly, you have 15 friends.
Yeah, these 15 friends will reduce with each open mic.
Yeah.
You know, call them too.
Probably. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. They're not gonna come. I have performed, like I DJ, so I've performed gigs, and with it's the same thing. Like the first few, everyone's like, "Oh, where you go?" The last few, like you message them. Bro, are you coming tonight? They'll
no.
leave you on scene. Like, no,
the worst part is, okay, I still remember when I used to go to mics from college, people would always say that, hey, dude, next time you're having a gig, let me know.
Yeah. Hey, people still say that.
Yeah, so I'm like, yeah, I'm going for one now, come. And then they'll be like, actually, I have work, you know. I cut tomorrow, maybe.
It's also a lonely problem. Even in my college, same college, like say different college, same place, they would be like, oh yeah, you're going, man, I really want to do something, man. Where is it? Sorry, where? I have to go have lunch. Come back.
Yeah, lonely, you can understand, bro. It's pretty far for them to just come and support
you. Yeah, but if I'm coming in an auto, you can just come now.
Oh, probably. But that's the thing, like, then you don't know, like, if they laugh, you're like, are they laughing because they're my friend, or are they like, I can, if you pack the audience also with people that you know, then you're going to get a lot of laughs because they are.
See, not necessarily. The one time I had, so there was this random gig we were doing that time, was in Vimannagar. 10 of my friends decided to surprise me, okay, and those assholes didn't laugh at a single joke.
Oh no.
So maybe I have asshole friends. I don't know, or maybe it's a joke, I don't know. But yeah, that's been my experience. So generally, I try avoiding taking friends because A, of course, the same reason that you said, but also B, sometimes they're just there to mess with you.
Yeah.
And when you're in the mood to just, you know, try a joke, which you want to do, you're writing, then...
But then I'll be too tempted to do crowd work with them, no? And I know, like, shit from their past.
But what crowd work will you do with them?
Don't do crowd work with people you know. It will be like...
I won't, but like, I'll be... I'm saying, oh, I'm not getting laughs. I know something about this guy. I'll ask a question to pull that information out.
Yeah. Hmm. Interesting.
That's exactly how, I mean, like Schulz, he doesn't know the people, but he goes with ideas. So all the crowd work sets, he's like, I have this idea. I'm going to find someone to get this out of so that I can make these jokes.
Mm. Yeah.
He's known for being so like on the spot. And a lot of it is that. But in one of the podcasts, he said, ki, I go with ideas and then I look for people.
Yeah, a lot of people, especially when it comes to hosting and stuff, right, where you have to do a lot of crowd work, people go with a set mindset. Okay, this is the area of, okay, bottle is what I'm going to talk about. So whatever conversation I have with this person, audience member, I'll pick up something from there. I've done it personally. I think you've
That's
also done
trick,
it a
right?
lot of times.
The common trick is that if your next joke is about birds, then you ask someone, say, hey, what's your name? By the way, do you do any hobbies? By the way, have you did this thing called bird watching? And then you you take it to the joke.
Just segue.
Segue to segue. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, some people just go all out like unrelated shit. Back to back. Like,
yeah, but the thing with what I have also seen is that not always does that work.
Yeah, you have to be really good. Like the jokes individually have to be really good.
They have to hit.
Mitch Hedberg was that none of the jokes had anything to do with the next one, right?
Oh.
But he was just, each joke was so good by itself.
Mm-hmm.
I've seen Mitch Hedberg doing crowd work. There is one lone YouTube video where he's doing a college gig and it's out in the open, okay? He doesn't talk to a single person, but he's doing crowd work for 15 minutes. He's just commenting about everything around him. Be like, this is an open gig, so it doesn't matter where I face. Yeah. He faces the other.
I can't imagine him doing, half the time though his eyes are closed. Like when he's like, sometimes you can see like his eyes are closed and his hands are shaking. I don't know, was that the drugs or was it?
So he's known to have anxiety. He used to wear the glasses and have the hair in front because he didn't want to see the audience.
Well, you can tell that he's clearly not comfortable being there.
Mm-hmm. Mm.
But then he's still killing that hard.
Yeah.
Like he's someone that...
So what I've also read is that he didn't used to kill that hard.
Hmm.
Like even the special that is taped.
Yeah.
Right? He bombed for about half that special.
Yeah.
And then they...
You cover my side and then he'll... At the end of it, they came on his side.
Yeah.
Oh, shit.
So he bombed for half that special. Like, he bombed so hard that he gave up and he sat down on stage. And then he started... But he never gave up. He just trudged through the jokes.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
Even the big shows that he did, like, when he went on late night shows,
mm-hmm.
he'd fumble a lot and, like, some of the jokes wouldn't work. But then he was just, like... That was his thing.
Yeah.
Being nervous and anxious.
Mm-hmm.
Even here, like Mohammed Suhail, his whole thing is being awkward and like being not being comfortable.
But Suhail, I feel, is not that like he's pretty confident on stage.
He more than being his thing, I feel he's just alt. Initially, when I used to think that he was very like it was about this whole shyness.
Yeah, but I think he's getting better now, so
he's
that shyness
changing.
Is going.
Yeah,
away.
He's also changing a lot. Like he's got this one. His new R is on just jokes about the space.
Hmm.
Yeah. Oh, I haven't seen that.
That is so risky. Like to write an R about space.
Yeah.
What if like you?
But that's a great space to be in, also.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah, that's the thing. If you have something unique to talk about, and like you keep exploring that, even if you do an R on it,
mm-hmm.
you'll still have people on your side. You'll still like how many flight jokes can you crack? How many? If you guys have flight jokes,
I don't think.
I had one, and then somebody told me that Karan Gill has the same joke.
Oh,
so then I dropped
yes.
it, and then it came in his special in the Netflix special.
Yes.
It was the same thing about silent airports.
Yeah,
and how they tell
you
it's silent by announcing it.
Oh, yeah.
So that was the only flight joke I had.
One more thing I wanted to ask you guys. When you write something, how do you know that no one's done this before?
And we don't.
Until
somebody comes and
tells you.
Yeah. And there'll always be one annoying bugger who'll come like, bro, actually, I've heard this somewhere.
Yeah, in 1764.
Actually, this is a dumb
farmer
thought.
Had come.
Yeah.
This joke.
That is always something like when I'm writing stuff, I write it, I'm like, man, I think someone's done this before.
I feel like don't think about it at that point.
Yeah.
Like
yeah.
someone, the industry is such that someone will come and
tell you.
If it is even remotely related.
You will be informed.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, what's worse is that those jokes will kill 100%. Because you know that it's that good that someone must have like come up with it. Like if the premise is that relatable, then probably someone has come up with
mm-hmm.
it. With tweets, it's easy. Sometimes if I'm tweeting something, I want to know if someone's done it before. So you just look up the keywords.
Mm-hmm.
And then if a tweet similar to that is there, it'll come up.
Tweet, man, doesn't matter, man. Nobody's going to
say I don't
want to
be unoriginal on Twitter also. Yeah.
But yeah, I think it's... People always end up telling you, and at the end, it doesn't bother me.
Hmm.
Like somebody once had told me that this joke is somebody does your joke. I was like, okay, cool, let them.
Yeah.
I don't.
Yeah.
Fine.
Yeah. But that happens, man. Even like with big comics, I've seen similar
mm-hmm.
bits. This guy Trevor Noah does this bit. I mean, I don't know how much of a comic Trevor Noah is, but he does this
mm-hmm.
bit about Russian people who speak Russian, and Russell Peters has done like pretty much the same joke.
Yeah.
And
every stereotype he's done it.
No, they're like it's Russian is like if someone's speaking in reverse.
Mm-hmm.
So he does this whole where he's like rewinding the tape and
mm-hmm.
doing a
mm-hmm.
Russian accent. So then Russell Peters on this podcast, he gets all pissed off. He's like, Trevor Noah's lifting my jokes. Russell Peters is really struggling. I don't know if you guys
really?
Right now.
Yeah, I mean he's the first comic that most of us.
He was my introduction.
He was my introduction to comedy.
To stand up comedy. They were like, hey, look, this guy talking. This Indian dude.
The Indian dude. That was my hook into it.
Yeah.
Was all zero. That was. You know that how they invented zero. He had this bit which went very viral.
No, the one that I got onto was the Chinese bag one.
Oh, yeah.
Mm. Yeah, be a man.
Yeah, yeah.
Be a man.
Yeah.
Yeah, all those bits that you, that shitty quality YouTube videos back in the day. Yeah, so he peaked too early, and then he just toured and toured, never did a podcast, never put the material was just the YouTube videos, and now he's like, he got divorced like 2-3 times.
Oh,
and he has kids with each wife, so he's all fucked up. And then he started a podcast recently, and the podcast doesn't even get views. It's fucked up. Like, how can a Russell Peters podcast not get views?
That's sad.
Like, come on, man. Like imagine, like, even if Russell Peters came to India, I'm sure it will be sold out.
Didn't he come to India recently?
I watched him live in Pune only.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, but the show was all right. I mean, it was one of those huge
arenas,
so it's not very... And he was doing crowd work half the time. And then with him, he is kind of figured out with the Indian crowd. Like the Indian crowd who goes to watch Russell Peters, they're not stand-up fans. They're just
Russell Peters fans. Yeah.
Just want to hear
knows,
him say Russell.
Yeah, that. And he knew if he says Bhenchod, done. Chill, bro. Yeah. Like the crowd is erupting. All these uncles and aunties are like, oh, yeah. Russell.
Russell.
So, yeah. Well, my point is, like, even if you're that big, like, content-wise, you have to really
keep putting out
and keep putting out good shit. Like, just because of your, like, just because you're Russell Peters doesn't mean your shit is going to do well.
I guess that's true, yeah. Because, like, I mean, at all points in time, you're competing with the newest video that dropped, right? Because now that we have YouTube, we have so much internet access, right?
Yeah.
You're always competing with the next video that's going to come out.
Yeah.
And you might today you drop like a 10 minute stand up bit. Okay, that's mind blowing. Tomorrow somebody will put out a 30 second 15 second reel.
Yeah.
And that will blow up more than what you did 2 days back.
Yeah.
I feel like YouTube reel may not compete, but somebody might put out just like another video, and that video will just be like, who was that?
Exactly. Yeah, that's what.
Is that what comics work towards, like that first YouTube video in India, at least? Because in India, YouTube is where you get discovered.
Right?
And where
there are many approaches, is what I have seen.
Yeah, of course. Like YouTube is not everything. Of course.
Yeah. Mm. So sure, like Akash Mehta does a great thing where he sees YouTube as this way of how people will get to know him. Right. So it's not. So he treats YouTube as separate, and then. Stand-up as a separate thing, entity
together.
Some
crazy, he has some like 6 hours and stuff.
Yeah.
He has 6 different hours.
Oh, shit. But then the stuff he uploads is mostly crowd work and...
Right? Yeah, so that's the thing, right? Like, he's building that audience. So now somebody will watch the YouTube video and then you're like, okay, I like this guy.
Yeah.
Let me go check him out.
Yeah.
Somebody
so
just
it's
consistently
almost...
putting out content.
Yeah.
Kind of like Andrew Schultz, you can
exactly,
say.
Yeah.
How many... bits have you seen Andrew Schultz do? Not many. He hasn't posted many. It's just crowd work and crowd work.
Mm-hmm.
And then his shows are solo. I don't even know if he has an R. I'm pretty sure he does.
He does, he does.
But like, no one has seen...
It was supposed to be... His special was supposed to be taped. And then the pandemic started.
Yeah.
So then that got canned. And then later he came out with Schultz Saves America, which wasn't, I'm guessing, the special.
It was just...
It was just that whole Instagram thing that he was doing. But now...
Now as a whole thing.
As a Netflix thing.
Yeah.
But yeah, so that's one approach. The other approach is a lot of people just put their all their blood, sweat into one video.
Hmm.
And some people get viral on that.
Yeah.
And they'll get like a 10 million views or something, whatever.
Yeah.
But for some people, it doesn't work out. So it really depends. A lot of people are now starting using Instagram a lot.
Hmm.
So the stuff that they don't post on YouTube, they put on Instagram.
Yeah.
So
Reels, crowd work stuff.
Yeah.
Even with Reels, if you're just posting, not stand-up, just if you're a funny person on the internet or a relatable person, you're going to sell tickets.
Yes, and Reels is a different art form only, I've realized. Because I get very like, this take needs to be really good. And then I screw up and I'm like, no, I'll take 60 more takes. And then my phone dies down on battery.
It's not easy. It's definitely like putting content out on Reels. It's not as easy.
Every day.
Think. Yeah, every day, dude. Some of these 16-year-old kids who are blowing up, they're like, the content isn't something that you're like, oh, wow, so much work must... But too consistently...
They put a lot of stuff.
Yeah.
They put too much. Too much. For sometimes I think, how do you think like this every day? Like what, today you are making observations about drinking water, tomorrow taking...
But then you're getting rewarded instantly now with each reel. So that, yeah, that keeps you going.
So the question that then I have here is that rewarding or rewards is a very subjective thing in my opinion, right? For somebody, gaining a follower is a reward.
Yeah.
For me, on the other hand, is getting somebody to my live gig.
Yeah,
giving me their $100 to watch me do an hour.
It's not just that. Like, see, even if it doesn't blow up more than your thing, I've started getting this thing where every time you get a like, it's that instant validation that you need.
The,
it's like
it's a dopamine.
Yeah.
Hit. Yeah.
Like, I think it is a dopamine.
Yeah.
Hit. Like,
yeah, it is.
As soon as your phone lights up.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Is that whole thing that okay? I always constantly want to be around my phone. Or boy, did I get a notification? Did I get a call?
Yeah.
And that's kind of messed up. It does happen.
Yeah.
But I find it to be
you
very
almost
messed
as
up.
Like you start associating it with comedy because now too there is we can't do live shows and we are like okay let's grow our Instagram following so once we do that and then Instagram doesn't just become like an application that you do for fun
now it's work
it's work exactly
it's like oh I this is where I'm like gaining stuff for my comedy so I don't even feel guilty about checking it too often like oh I'm doing it for comedy but
but that's the thing no like. With I spoke about comics who are posting like trends, they're doing trends and stuff. They know that it may convert to ticket sales. And what I've noticed is it doesn't even have to be comedy. Like right now, because of this podcast, I've been posting reels and stuff and it's gotten me some traction. The last time I did a gig, like a DJ gig, people showed up because they had watched the podcast.
Oh, nice.
And they were like, and they have nothing to do with each other.
Yeah.
They're like, oh, we know this guy. He's playing. Let's go watch.
Yeah.
So they're just there for you instead of...
Correct, yeah. A lot of comics did that during the pandemic. Like, when they started making a lot of reels, right? The point was not that, hey, okay, I'm just trying to be a teenager. But was to build this whole space that, okay, you know, I have time. I still need to work to figure this shit out.
And some of them... Probably they were like, oh, fuck, this shit works. Let's keep doing it.
Let's keep
doing
it.
Yeah.
And they have managers and all, bro. And they're like, you need to put shit out.
Yeah. I know people, like, I know people, like, not know them directly, but, like, they're managed by these talent agencies.
Yeah,
and they make reels and stuff. TikToks, reels.
Media influencers.
Yeah, exactly. And they get sponsorship from time to time.
Yeah.
So
I work at Scoopoo, we have all those.
You're the problem.
On the daily. Yeah, actually, that's true.
Those agencies.
I work every day. My job is just literally opening a laptop and be like, what a horrible person I am. What a horrible thing I'm doing. I am the problem. This should never happen in art. Okay, close laptop.
Yeah. But then now you guys, like, you do you see yourself doing stand up full time at some point? Are you doing stand-up full-time right now?
No, not at the present
moment.
You're
working.
I have a job, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
I have a job.
What's wrong in seeing myself?
No.
Yeah, seeing myself every day. Doing
I love
comedy.
Seeing myself as a
I see myself doing comedy at the O2 Arena every day.
Yeah.
Well, you have to, no? You have to visualize.
You have to visualize
and
it.
And also work.
Yeah. Yeah, true. That's the sad part. But yeah, I don't mind doing it, dude. If at some point in time, it gives me, like, helps me get through life.
Yeah.
Like, pays my rent.
Yeah, that's why I told my mom. I was like, I could do a corporate job and live a decent life. And how far will it go?
Mm-hmm.
Like a corporate, there's only so much you can grow, right? Yeah. Or I could try this thing out, give it everything, and then maybe I'll make as much as a corporate only. But then I'm doing something fun, and I'm making that much. And this one has so much more room for growth. I said that and she was like, no.
And this one has so much more room for growth.
That's okay.
Yeah, but then what are you going to do? That, but the thing with parents is until they see results, there's no reason for them to believe in you.
Yeah. Which is also understandable, I feel.
They're looking out for you.
Exactly.
They don't want you to fuck your life up.
One little trick I've noticed is that the only thing that kind of helped me with my parents' situation is, I didn't tell them only.
Yeah.
But I've had a lot of, I'm going to Bombay, doing trips where my parents don't know about it and stuff like that. Don't get me into all this dark past material. But anyway, so the one thing that kind of helped was that my dad finds this in IIT Holi. I'm sure a lot of like everyone
shares. Yeah.
So I got some, I did some show in IIT Mood Indigo, I think they have that fest or something. So I had opened for Rahul Subramanyam at that point. I didn't think it was like a big deal. It was a lot of audience.
Yeah.
But I was like, okay, nice. So some, my dad's friend's child who, not child, person, boy, kid,
person, I like that you went with person, then child.
Child just seems weird.
Son.
son, yes.
An atom was there.
So, my dad's friend's son was in IIT and my dad looks up to that guy. Huh. So, he had come to Mood Indigo and saw me perform and then he called my dad's friend called my dad and he's like, oh, your son is in Mood Indigo. And my dad was like, first of all, why did you go to Bombay? And second of all, good job.
Oh, damn.
Yeah.
So is that the first time he knew you were doing stand-up?
No, no, he knew. He just didn't know, like, how the much I used to do it and how, like, how good I was.
Yeah.
Oh,
damn. I think the case is quite similar in a lot of...
Yeah.
Like, even for me, initially, like, they knew I was doing... But they always thought, yeah, okay, cool. He's doing it once in six months.
He's doing it for fun.
Side hobby.
Yeah, side hobby. They still think it's a side hobby. But
not
like,
even a hobby.
Yeah, it's like a side hobby.
Side hobby.
There's another main hobby, you know, like coding or something he'll be doing.
Coding.
But like
side watering plants. That is the side of that stand-up. Sometimes he'll tell jokes to plants also.
So like over a period of time, then I also realized that, okay, you know what, there's no point in hiding from them, because the more you hide, the more they'll be like, no, can't do this, you can't. So you start tell them information, not everything, but palatable information.
Go in steps.
That's the thing I keep telling people, ki lying is not always bad. Like, to your parents at least.
White lies.
Lies that you're saying for their own good. Like, you know that information will probably upset them. But it's not that bad also. That it ideally shouldn't upset them. Like, don't lie to your parents about doing drugs and all. But like,
don't be honest with them. Just tell them you're doing drugs. Just, mom, I did drugs today.
What is this? Is the smell of cigarette? No, ganja actually.
I used to have these neighbors in this... Before I moved into this house, we used to have these neighbors, like bachelors. So they'd be smoking up the whole time.
Uh-huh.
So my house was always smelling of weed. So this one day I'm like, Mom, these people on the side, they're always smoking up. I'm like, oh, smoking up. I'm like, yeah. Like, how do you know what it smells like? I was like, then she started doubting. Then I was like, fuck, my house smells of weed all the time. So I would just go in my room, do whatever I wanted to, and I'd come down and be like, these neighbors. The whole time.
Today there's too much smoke.
It was so much smoke, man. These neighbors.
So don't lie to your parents about doing drugs. But so then
lie in moderation.
That's what I say.
I do this thing. I used to do this thing. No, I don't do it anymore.
That's the problem, you know, the side note. That's the problem. You don't know which video of yours your parent is going to watch online. So now that you... I used to do, but I'm sorry.
No, that's the thing with the story you said, that IIT gig. Luckily, you do clean material. Now, if you did some... Like, if you were doing some hardcore sex jokes and then...
My mom and dad have come to my show and it was a show 10 feet underground or something that room was. I don't know if you were there. Samay was hosting that show. That time he wasn't like big. He hadn't been comics then and I was doing it. And they had come and everyone on the lineup decided to do the most abusive set that they did that day.
Like,
they came with their friends, okay? They are like, you'll see what our son is doing. Right from the get-go. And then I did clean stuff because I anyway do clean stuff. Yeah. And they never came back to any gig.
Like that one kid at the party, like, Mama, I don't do all this.
But maybe they didn't come back because they wanted to see you do dick jokes.
Yeah, they were like...
Yeah, maybe they wanted you to do some adult content.
They wanted me to
do that's why they saw that, oh, this is too clean, it's not our kind of shit, bro. So then they
But I honestly appreciate I appreciate clean material because it's so much harder, I think, to write.
Yeah.
I don't really do like this conscious decision. I've just not been that person.
I just don't
for
like sex
time.
As much.
I have no sex experience. That's like I have some now.
A little here and there.
But the thing.
But after that coach, Chennai fuck up.
Yeah, now I don't know. But the thing is that it doesn't show up in my life that often that I think about it that much.
But the question is that what is adult content? What is non-clean content?
Clean is like probably not, you don't cuss and you don't talk about
sex and stuff.
Yeah.
But what's the problem? Like, why does it talking about sex make it?
I mean, nothing is wrong.
I'm not questioning
it like that. I'm just trying to understand, right? Why? How does one define? Like, I know it's very subjective, but how does one define what becomes clean, what is not clean?
Oh, that way.
Yeah. Like for me, I don't mind. I have a problem talking about condoms. Mm. That's clean for me.
Yeah.
But for somebody else, that might not be. So.
Condoms are not that clean.
Yeah, after you use them. Before the, it's cool.
I don't know, man. Like with stuff like that, like some comics probably intentionally talk about sex because they're like, oh, this is so people want to hear about this. They want to hear dirty stuff. But some comics really enjoy talking about sex.
Yeah.
Like you listen to Nikki Glaser.
Yeah.
She's actually having, like she's obsessed with what she's talking about.
Mm-hmm.
And she's said it multiple times. She's like, I actually enjoy talking about sex as much. Every podcast she does, she just talks about sex. There's nothing else that she ever talks about.
I have a theory about it. It's because the not of Nikki Glaser.
Nikki Glaser is gonna watch this video and comment. Thank you, Tarang Adigar, for
imagine.
You know, dissecting my mentality.
In the sense, I just think that because it's just an expression that you like, nobody tells you to, everyone's like, don't talk about, don't talk about, don't talk about. So then it's like you're revolting against that, which is like a genuine expression.
Yeah.
That's for any comic. Like, the main reason, I think, a big reason a lot of people want to do stand up is because they have so much to say and they've never had
a chance
like,
to say
a
it.
Chance or a stage.
Yeah,
to
yeah
share
man.
No, but when I was talking to Sumedh, he told me, if you can write clean for a year and just do open mics, just to learn writing jokes, that will be very helpful because you'll just get better at writing jokes because you don't have much to work with. But then, I don't think people want to do a year of practice. Everyone's
but
just
that's
going
a them
into,
problem, dude.
Yeah.
If they don't, if you don't do it, you're gonna
I mean
suck.
I have mixed feelings about that. I mean, I feel like if you're just writing something just to do writing practice, it won't be genuine.
Maybe. But like, so this is how I see it. Like, for me, a clean joke would be a joke written from the perspective of making a joke, not for, hey, I want to talk about sex.
Yeah.
You get the point.
Yeah.
Like if I do that for a year where I'm just writing, I'll write about taboo topics, but it's about writing the joke, not about be like.
Yeah, it's the intention.
Yeah.
And I think it's okay sometimes to say stuff just to like, if you want to say something gross just to get a reaction, but that's on you. I mean, if you want to do that, I feel like a lot of people just say stuff not, maybe to not get a laugh. Maybe at some part of your bit, you don't want a laugh. You want
attention.
To put in an idea or you want to get a reaction, some pullback.
Even when you do a set, right, it's not a line, it goes up and down.
Yeah.
Right?
That's my special idea. That is why, ladies and gentlemen, line is not a line.
So that's what, right, sometimes you want the audience to pull back, that pressure to develop more, so that, you know, when you drop the joke, it just explodes.
And sometimes, like, I've seen comics, they're silent for like a few seconds. They want to build the tension up,
That tension building is a
thing.
Yeah.
It's a skill.
It messes with me though on stage.
Yeah.
Even after doing it for so long, it messes with me on stage.
Or just the silence?
Yeah, because I'm always like, when I've practiced it at home, I know I have to take 3 seconds here. Mm-hmm. But on stage, I'm like, shit.
Three seconds
is too long.
Yeah.
Do you practice at home? Like, do you say it out loud before you go on stage?
I have now, because of practicing at home, I have become an addict to looking into a mirror. Wherever I see my reflection, I have to look into it.
Yeah.
So, I make sure I don't see myself. I go to the bathroom and tell boys jokes.
Do you also say them out loud before you?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I like first whenever it comes, I just write it. But then when I'm before I go on stage, I don't say it word to word. But I'll just try to like whatever. I pretend I'm on stage and then do whatever riff.
But that is that an approach that everyone takes, or some people just go on stage and
differs from people comic to comic, I guess.
Yeah. And with writing, do you write line by line and then go and perform, or do you like, okay, I have this idea, I'm gonna go and try, like I'm gonna go to an open mic and try this idea out, see where it goes?
I write something. It might not be the thing I say over there, but I write something.
Yeah, like the thought is the thought is in that space. I'm going to talk about this glass and write some observations sometimes.
Yeah.
Sometimes I won't even write. I'll have a thought in my head. I'll just record it on a voice note or something. And then reach to some semblance of a setup punchline, like form some joke, like a skeletal thing to at least put the thought out there.
Yeah.
Because for me personally, what happens is that in the first go, I never get a joke. Not in the first go, I never get the thought either. I know what the thought is. I just can't formulate into words.
Okay.
So
like you just see something and you're like, hey, this could be funny.
Yeah.
You write it down.
You know why it's funny for you? You just can't figure out how
exactly.
How do I explain this?
Yeah.
Then you have to make them see it from your, like you have to bring them there, right?
Yeah.
Like,
I tell you that bird beat was a big struggle.
I've actually seen you do that at open mics and it not work. I've seen you do it and
it
then
still doesn't work. But before that, I didn't have the punchline and I was just talking about, you know how birds, and nobody was like, oh, what are you saying?
So what, you were doing that so that you can figure out a punchline on stage?
Yeah, I thought sometime I might get something. I was telling it to Ameya Halur and in the spur of the moment, I said something and now that's the
point. Yeah. This is what I've noticed happen to a lot of people, even me, is that the more number of times you talk about that observation or that topic, right, the more firmer the thought becomes in your head.
Yeah.
And then you know, okay, maybe this is not what I was trying to say, but this is what I was trying to say.
Okay.
And that's when you like, okay, this is the premise, this is the setup. Then the joke becomes much easier to get to.
Yeah.
So that's what, at least how I use open mics, is that to, you know, sharpen the thought. Because the joke can be written.
Yeah.
If the premise is not understood, if the premise is not clear.
Yeah, sometimes you see something, you're like, hey, this is so relatable, but then really only you've thought about it.
Yeah.
But there is something in the premise or the words that you're using that is throwing people off.
Yeah, but then I think that's the beauty of it, right? Getting people on your page.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And then you're like, now you know what I'm talking about. Now I'll tell you why it's funny.
Yeah.
Oh, this is becoming like a understanding comedy.
This is a wholesome podcast episode.
I'm going to title it like trying to understand stand up.
Yeah. While we are also trying.
But what did you do before your first time when you went up on stage? How did you prepare yourself?
So I had written the jokes down. So with me, it's all the material that I did was about myself, because I'm originally from Iran. I moved to India in 2004. So that whole experience, it's like this huge box filled with ideas,
right?
Like as an my experience as a 6-year-old to now, like growing up in India. So it's like how stuff is different. Like I talked about how lucky, like I made jokes about how lucky you guys are with the current government. Like, this is like a dream.
Yeah.
Shit like that.
Right.
But then with that stuff, I don't know if I want to keep doing it. Like starting off with political comedy, I don't think it's not super political. Like I'm not making fun of any specific person, but then I don't know if that's what I want to do.
It's fair enough.
But nice. Ideas along those lines only, because I feel like storytelling is what I want to do eventually. So I want to go in that direction. I just wrote jokes with punchlines and I went and delivered them somehow. Some of the stuff that I didn't know was funny got laughs. Some of the punchlines didn't get laughs. So it's just the
that
whole...
That happens all the time.
So what, this is just a general question. What do you do after the gig then? Like I know what you do. But like
I went, I got pizza
I actually went to the washroom.
Actually, I got off stage.
Yeah. And I went a little bit. I watched some Dice Tower YouTube channel.
No, I had recorded. I recorded the whole thing.
Mm-hmm.
There was no mic, so I held my phone as a mic, and I was recording the whole thing. And I listened to it. And I was like, it was okay. Mm-hmm.
It's do you cringe listening to your own voice?
Very.
Oh, fuck yeah. I do a podcast.
How do you edit it, man?
I have to edit it. And bro, I still watch it. Like after editing it, I'm like, let me see what it looks like on YouTube.
Yeah, I also do that. Because then it's almost like you imagine yourself being another person. Who's like, oh, let me see who's this thing. And then you check it out to see if you playing the other character likes this thing.
Yeah. Yeah.
I'm a bit obsessive about that. I watch it on a different phone.
See what it looks like.
Yeah. So that I'm fully immersed in a different person.
Yeah, some people change clothes.
I mean, you should be able to watch your own content and like it. Like, people see their own stories, bro. Like, you post a story and you watch it and you're like, hey.
Yeah, I watch my own stories.
Yeah. Sometimes like, wow.
Yeah, like, wow, kya thought tha, whoa. what am I looking, dude? Whoa.
Yeah,
but I can't watch my essay old. Like, I have to push myself a lot to do it. Like, recently I did, like, I was trying to do a series where I just put out reels where I bombed from my old videos. So I found a lot of them and they were damn cringy, and it took me a long time to even, like, I think I put out 3 or 4. It took me a lot of time to find the ones that were okay, passable, and that I didn't cringe a lot at.
And I don't want to burn material also.
Exactly. So it's more than about you not liking your own voice. It's also what I realized was I didn't like a lot of my old material also.
So
the cringe was from the voice plus the material.
But that's with anything, bro. You look at your old chats and you're like, what the fuck was I saying? Or like, I listen to... like some of the gigs that I played, I was like, fuck, I really play that song? Bro, like, I watched my last podcast, I was like, what the fuck did I just say? If you're talking for an hour, you're bound to say a few things that are not funny and problematic also. I've said a lot of problematic shit.
No, there is this happened a lot, not problematic, but Advit knows this. I have no idea. I can't understand double meaning jokes. That's my... I can't. And people always say that to me. They're like, oh, you're a comedian, right? Then they tell me a joke. It's a double meaning joke. I'm like, oh, yes, sorry. And they're like, oh, but you're a comedian. So this happens to me a lot whenever I'm performing. I say something randomly in crowd work that obviously has a double meaning according to everyone. So they laugh. And I'm like, wow, man, I'm such a funny guy. My joke is getting such a reaction. So I just thought I am there laughing at my crafting of words.
Yeah.
They're laughing at the absurdism that I bring to the table. And I get away.
Double meaning, like, you don't get puns also? Or just
puns as in, like, I get all the normal double meaning like that. Popular double meaning jokes. Just some stuff.
Then, what's a popular double meaning joke?
Like, you know, those, that's what she said.
Oh, that, I was going to say, that's what she said.
Oh,
yeah.
Okay.
What do you mean you don't get it? Then the jokes must be bad, no, if you don't get it. Or do you, like, not know enough words or what's happening?
Dude, Tarang is damn naive, okay? Let's Tarang, there is Tarang and then there is buffering Tarang. Okay. Sometimes, you know, Tarang is just in buffering. You don't know what's happening there.
Sorry, what did you say?
Did you guys coordinate what you were going to wear, or it's just...
Even I realized after I sat down, I realized that we are twinning.
Yeah, it's gonna look damn good, the shot.
Yeah,
it's gonna look
nice.
I'll make this a thumbnail. how long have you guys known each other now? And
I think since we started comedy.
Yeah, so...
Around 4 years?
4 years.
4 or 5 years.
Four years. Nah, I think we properly got to know each other 3 years, I think.
Yeah, but we knew of each other for about four or 5 years.
Are all of your friends comics?
Yes.
No, not all of my friends.
Have you guys ever, like, beefed with some comic? Like, you had a fight or some shit's gone down, some drama?
No.
Yeah, never. Tell me a bit.
That's not the case. I don't recall. No, yeah, like, we've had altercations, of course. Like, just basic ones. But I think that they always happen. I've seen it happen in all the places.
Why don't you guys make it public then? I feel like more comedians should be.
Also like sports. Yeah, actually, you know, that would be a cool, like, you know how they have those rap battle beats?
Yeah,
like, we had actually thought of this, you know. So there was this one point in time where audience was not coming for gigs in Pune. So like 5-6 of us, I think you were also there. We just decided that, you know what, we'll stage a fake fight here. What is this comics?
People will come to watch. Like, have you guys heard of coconut tree?
Well, drama gets so much, like, it gets the most traction somehow.
Yeah, I want to do like a Big Boss kind of thing with comics. That's like my.
They did now something on Netflix where you have to make.
You have to make each other laugh, but you can't laugh. Yeah, but that was not, they were not staying in the place. Like, I mean, like, proper, like, you know, you.
That's probably already a pitched and rejected idea.
Maybe, yeah, could be possible.
No, bro, that I can't imagine living with. How do those Big Boss people do it, man? It's painful to watch them.
Live with someone.
To live with those people.
Yeah, to live with a lot of people.
Everything is being recorded.
Yeah.
So what I've heard is not everything gets recorded.
Oh. Yeah, I mean
everything gets recorded, not everything gets shown. So a lot of times what happens is that all these people on set, no, they go inside the house and chill with these people.
Hmm.
Is what I've heard.
That would be a better show. Big Boss deleted scenes.
Probably.
Extended edition. Yeah, you know, like Snyder's cut, Big Boss.
But, don't you think comics should beef more? Like public beef?
Comics beef in general. All the time you'll find some comic beefing about somebody else.
Yeah.
Or beefing with somebody else.
Any industry.
Bitching is
I
in
think.
Our nature.
Yeah. So, it's always happening.
Yeah.
But it's that beef, no, it's not spicy. You know what I'm trying to say?
Yeah.
Like, it's spicy if you know the comics.
Yeah.
Comics are the most boring people off stage.
Yeah. Like, if you don't know if you have no context until and unless that person got hit, nobody's gonna watch that video.
Yeah.
For sure.
But the thing about them being boring is I feel like after a while you realize ki this is my job. I have to be funny when I'm on stage. I don't have to be funny otherwise. Like, I don't need to be funny.
Yeah.
Maybe at the start you're trying to prove yourself. Oh, I'm gonna, I'm around comics. I'm gonna make them laugh. But then later you realize, okay, I should stop. I realize that with my friends. Like, not even as a comedian, I'm like, fuck. I don't need to be funny all the time. Sometimes you find yourself talking in bits.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like, you're doing a bit with your friend while you're talking to him. You're like, why am I doing this?
Yeah.
For what?
I used to do that. Then I started checking out, like, actively checking out, you know, when I caught myself. And then it became like a thing where people were like, oh, when I just randomly start ranting, no, I got mad.
Yeah.
How the fuck?
Yeah.
They're like, hey, bit karana, bit karana, bit karana.
This happens too much.
And then it becomes annoying because now you genuinely have a thought and you have an opinion about something, but everybody can't stop seeing that you're going to make it a joke, which I will, but first let me get my point across.
Yeah. That thing gets tricky, man. Like, even in relationships, in the past, I've realized they're like, yo, why are you always like this? Like, switch, turn it off at times. You don't have to constantly be like, I like it when you make me laugh, but it doesn't have to be all the
time.
Dude,
I relate with this.
Really?
Yes.
The only relationship, my relationship, both are comics.
Have you seen that meme? Where the girlfriend is talking to the boyfriend, she's annoyed with him, and she's like, I'm furious. And he turns around and says, but are you fast?
Yeah.
I have done that.
Nice. How did that go?
I'm single right now.
But so. That works sometimes. If the girl's angry and you.
But
the joke has to.
Yeah, I thought it would work.
Yeah.
And it would diffuse the situation. It did.
It would work in my. Because I'm reading a comic, so she would love it.
How is that? Is it. Everything that you say right now is going to be held against
you. Oh, man.
It's
no,
great.
It's like, I mean, it's the greatest experience. It is like we come up with bits all the time.
Hmm.
And then it's always a problem of like, no, you take it. No, you take it.
Shit.
What a cute couple.
Yeah, we're two positive people. No most polite people that can.
But then, like, let's say you there's a bit, and then you know you've done most of the work, and then she takes it and it kills, and she makes a video, it's viral. What do you do then?
Then I don't know what to do, man.
No matter how nice you are, thoda to you'll feel no. Okay.
Yeah. I mean, hasn't happened that often actually.
Yeah.
But yeah.
I think I would be damn jealous. Yeah.
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah.
I feel like it'll only work if both of you are doing damn well. If one person isn't doing that well, the other person is doing damn well, then it gets a little tricky. Look at me as if I know. It's like. do you guys ever meet someone who's like really funny and then you're like,
doing comedy?
Yeah.
Yes.
Do you do that all the time?
Yes. A lot of my friends are hilarious and I want them to do, but they're not.
But then hilarious, how? Like hilarious, they'll talk about something which is between you. Then it's easy to, because the premise is super.
No.
They're
just
about
hilarious.
Something. Yeah.
They're just very hilarious people.
Yeah.
I think a lot of my friends in general are very funny. But they don't do comedy. For whatever reason, then they don't.
I have this one friend. I've literally quoted his jokes to like all of the comics that I know. And they're like, even the big comics are like, oh, it's brilliant.
Yeah.
Who came up with this? The guy who doesn't even try comedy. His name is Anshit Kannamuri.
Antics.
But that's, even with me, like you say something and someone comes with like a snappy comeback who's super funny. I'm like, fuck, man. Like, to think of this, you need some sort of, you need to be kind of.
That is my indicator to make that person a friend. That is how I operate. If I think that person has made me laugh like crazy, I really want to be that person's friend.
Yeah. I mean, that's all. Being funny is a superpower.
Yeah.
I've realized. Like, if with guys also, I'm like, man, if you're funny, you're going to get chicks. Like, it's
debatable.
No, I don't know. I feel like everyone wants to
depends on, this is just my observation, it depends on what kind of a humor you have. You have the kind of a humor where you roast people and get the laughs, or you have the kind of a humor where you like put your opinion on topics, then you know, like the girls see you as someone who's like, oh, dominant, you know, then they get attracted to you. But if you have the kind of self-deprecating humor or a reverse humor where you just say, have you ever seen birds?
So have you ever seen birds is not self-deprecating, what do you say?
I mean, it's not cool is what I'm saying. It's all like almost lame jokes.
Yeah, self-deprecation, I don't think it'll work with girls.
Yeah.
You never know. What if they're looking to,
guy with
heal someone, you know?
Or I'll fix him types.
Yeah.
Yeah.
What
if? That's not, those guys, the guys who are that fucked up, they're not making jokes. I don't think so. No?
Yeah, they would. Why not? I mean, people make jokes at random stages.
The more fucked up you are, I guess, the more jokes you make.
Yeah. How do you deal with those jokes? Like someone's dad has died and they make a dead dad joke. And
I love it.
Yeah.
But if you don't know the person that well, then it's a little awkward.
So, yeah,
it
is.
If they make it, I love
if
it.
If they have initiated it, I go.
Yeah.
We're on board now. We're taking this train.
Do you add to it also then?
If that person is comfortable with it, yes. Depending on, like, sometimes you just sense it, right? Like, if that person will be able to take a joke or not. If I'm not sure, I just ask, hey, do you mind if I... And then I just do it.
Do you mind if I add a tag?
Add a tag to your dead dad. Yeah. I just do that.
Well, sometimes it gets awkward. Like, and when it comes out of nowhere, and you don't expect it, and suddenly you're like...
What was that laugh?
Dude, I'm the king of awkward in a lot of situations. So, a lot of times...
Hello. I would go against you right now.
You are awkward. I make a situation awkward where somebody will say some shit, okay?
Yeah.
Like, there's a situation where this one lady was cheating on her husband with somebody else. Now, the husband passed away.
This is a real situation in their life.
This is a real situation in their life, okay? The husband passed away. So, everybody in the locality knows that person as, oh, the wife whose husband... No, what? You're the wife of the person who passed away.
I'm getting a feeling this is fake.
No, it's not. So that's how people knew of her. So the my friend was telling me about that, you know, this is that woman and some story around that. I said, okay, that's one way of looking at it. I mean, you can look at it that she's cheating also. So I thought it was hilarious, okay, in my head. But everybody just, you know. You felt people pull back, and then I was like, okay.
That happens all the time, though. It's like bombing around your friends. I feel like that's worse than bombing on stage. Like, if your own friends don't laugh at something you say, and you know you've specifically said it to their taste, you know, because you know what makes each friend laugh.
Because you have to know the audience after the show. My problem, this was like a big thing. When I was in college, I barely could talk to people. And I started comedy.
Yeah.
So now I had to host.
Yeah.
So people are like, hey, hosting is easy. Just go and talk to people. They're like, yeah, that is the problem actually. I can't talk to people. And it somehow happened. But that gave me a very hilarious one date experience. I've told you this story.
Yeah, you asked someone out.
I matched with someone, okay. And I was going to her place. And this was the first date I've ever been on.
Yeah.
I have no idea. I've been doing comedy. So the only thing I know is how to do comedy, how to be on stage.
Yeah.
I go to her place. Her roommate is there and her roommate's friend is also there. And they are sitting and I don't know how to like actually greet normal people. Yeah. So I start doing crowd work. Like, so where do you come from? Yeah. What is your name? Only thing was left to ask, how did you come to know about this show?
Do you guys know each other?
Are you all dating?
Oh, you're dating, then how will you date me? I did crowd work. Then I started doing, they were like, oh yeah, I do comedy, so this is one of my bits. Then I started doing a bit. They were like, oh yeah, they were loving it. I was killing it, destroying. So then I did about 30 minutes of material.
Oh wow.
Did proper 30 minutes of material.
This is a private show.
Yeah, and then after the show, after I did this material, I had no idea what to do because now I'm just sitting there, be like, hi, I'm just Tarang. And then I was
that
like,
was my time.
Yeah, and leave. Then I left.
Send them an invoice.
I'm leaving. Then
you
I realized.
Open mic.
I didn't go on a date. I did a private show for free. So that's when I realized that if you want to book me, just ask me out on Tinder. I'll do it for free.
Damn, bro. I get damn awkward though. My friends also say, "Oh, do one bit. Do." I'm like, man, this.
That's the worst.
Yeah.
When people put you on the spot.
Yeah. Do a joke.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Hey, joke suna na.
Yeah.
And the worst is when your relatives do it.
Oh yeah.
Have your relatives done that with you?
I don't tell my relatives. But the best thing is to say is like, this is my job. Like, I don't ask you to, like, if he's a mechanic, it's like, I don't ask you to fix a car in front of me.
So I got a counter to that also once.
What?
Like, yeah, I'll pay you, come.
How much?
$100.
Not bad.
Not bad. Yeah.
One joke.
Yeah. For one joke, not bad. Actually, it starts with one joke.
Yeah.
And then it becomes like, or suna. So, yeah.
Yeah. Do you guys think the scene will come back anytime soon in Pune?
I hope so, man. I really,
really
hope so.
Wanted to do.
Yeah. Stand up a few years ago was, I honestly thought Pune is going to be the place, like one of the places to do stand up. Like, there used to be sold out gigs all the time. There'd be big comics touring. Then naturally there'd be open mics also, but now it's just, I don't know. I want Pune to be one of the places because we have the people for it.
There is actually a possibility of us doing maybe like Sunday morning shows. Actually, the whole scene is waiting for this one guy who is currently on vacation right now. His name is Pratik Bedkar.
Pratik Bedkar, if you're watching this, please come back. We need you.
He has this room. He has Cube.
Yeah, you've been to Cube, right? Yeah. So he runs that venue.
Yeah.
So he is our godfather when it comes to comedy here in Pune.
Yeah.
So
he's
damn
sweet.
He's a great guy.
He told me once I asked him, it's like, how do you get a spot? He's like, just text me. And this one day I just came to watch and he comes to me. He's like, you want to go and do a spot? And I was like, no. You're supposed to tell me before.
I can imagine that. Bro, you want to go and do a spot?
Yeah. And he goes up to people also like he's doing a drug deal.
Yeah.
स्पॉट करेगा
आई थिंक प्रतीक बीडकर इज दिस लाइक प्रोड्यूसर हुज बीन इन सो फॉर सो लॉन्ग ही एवरी टाइम ही'ल ओनली डू द ओपन माइक ही'ल ओनली क्यूरेट द लाइनअप एंड देन ही'ल कॉल यू फ्रॉम बिहाइंड एंड डू अ जोक अबाउट द कॉमेडी करंटली ऑन स्टेज ही'ल बी लाइक ये इतना बॉम्ब कर रहा है कि ब्ला ब्ला पंच लाइन आई थिंक ही हैज एन आर नाउ
ऑफ जस्ट जोक्स ऑन कॉमेडी
या
बट देन सो व्हाट ही इज द ओनली वन हु इज डूइंग I mean,
no, so we, I we, so there are a bunch of people. Yeah, there are a bunch of people who organize. There's Tomato Crunch is there. There is Talent Trails is there, run by Pratik. Tomato Crunch is run by three comics: Arjun, Pradeep, and Manish. Yeah. There's Paid Comedy Club.
Yes.
Run by Kale. Yeah. So he keeps having shows and stuff. So yeah, it's slow. Sure.
Yeah.
We're also trying. We keep trying, but we fail miserably because
of doing shows.
Of just organizing stuff. Because having a day job and plus then also figuring this out becomes very hectic.
Trying to promote it.
Yeah.
Yeah. Even I've been thinking of like hosting. Mm-hmm. I don't know a room or just hosting shows because there is a venue.
Mm-hmm.
Like one of my friends has it, and we've been thinking about doing it. But every time we like we're like, "Chal, we'll start planning," then it's closed. But the place is a proper like small, and it's a restaurant. So it's a small, low ceiling, kind of dark.
Right. That's like a proper underground thing.
Sounds so
like a great room.
Yeah. So if we want to kind of do something and make it a place where, like, you know, you go here, this only comedy, and it like we can do gigs throughout the week also. But it's tricky to get people.
Of course.
Yeah.
But that's the thing, right? That has to be one start. Like even when we talk about Cube, right? Cube is one place where we regularly have shows.
Yeah.
And when we first started Cube, right? I think Samay had started Cube. And that time we'd get like two people.
Yeah.
One person, zero tickets. And that went on for a very long period of time. For I think a good year and a half. And then slowly things started to pick up. Then we started getting 15 people for open mics on a Thursday or a Friday.
Yeah. The last few that I attended at the Cube, they were all pretty much packed.
Yeah.
So that's what, like, the idea is then that you have to start not thinking that, oh, I need my return tomorrow.
No. Obviously, like, ideally, if you find a place that's not doing very well, so you're like, anyway, you're not doing that well. So let's try this. Maybe it'll work out for you. But then with stand-up in Pune, at least I've realized the marketing or the promotion, it hasn't reached like people my age or like my circles. Like college kids, it's mainly, from what I've seen, it's either like corporate people or either...
Really?
Or like people who are...
A lot of like, I don't think a lot of college kids come to Cube.
Yeah, like with at least the people that I know, I mean, I have a... big social circle that I've met people like all this while, and then none of them go and watch stand up because probably they don't know that there are these shows happening or they don't know enough. So I feel like there needs to be someone needs to come and tap that market
for sure. Definitely. I was under the impression that a lot of college people do come for this. Because I remember when, after the first lockdown had opened, when we were having low ticket sales, this was one of the reasons that colleges are not open, so students are not coming.
Yeah, no, like if you look at Simbi kids, and like they rarely will go for stand-up shows. Like even with the big comics that I've gone for shows, like the people, I've never seen a familiar face. I've never seen... So I think, and now maybe when colleges open again, if you send promoters, like how do these bars get college kids to come and drink? Like how?
Because they have alcohol.
Yeah, so if you do it at a venue with alcohol, then
maybe. I think like college kids have already have low jokes in their life to make them, and like, so you're an adult.
Yeah.
It's just job and your boss is scolding you. And you're like, let's.
But it's such a fun experience. So just watching live stand up. Like, if you haven't done it, you go and watch it. It's like it's something you can do weekend, like in the evening. Just go watch. It's like going and watching a movie, but better.
Yeah. That's what's happening also now, right? Like, initially when stand up started in India, people never thought of it like, okay, you know, this is like, okay, instead of watching a movie, I can go watch somebody perform, tell us jokes. Right. And now slowly, slowly that's happening where people are garnering their own audience. Big comics who've been doing it for a while, 10 years now.
Yeah. Right. I think so, now with Instagram and stuff like that, even like the smaller comics who are doing open mics, they'll start getting an audience if they're putting out content and if that's doing well.
Yeah.
And also I'm seeing big comics do podcasts now. That's just like picking up. Like in the US, you know, every comic has a podcast.
Yeah.
2-3 podcasts sometimes. Here now everyone started doing it and podcasts are picking up. So I feel like slowly, slowly,
a lot of comics is what I'm seeing, and maybe I could be wrong also about this, that a lot of comics are now getting like proper writing work also.
Yeah.
Like they're like writing for movies, shows,
functions, award shows,
everything, right?
Yeah.
So like just comedy writing also as a thing is now picking up, in my opinion, which was not there before.
Yeah.
Right, so that's also something that's cool that's happening. Right, in the States, you have stuff like comics write a movie, and then you know there's no hassle in making it. Yeah. We're getting there. It's slow.
Yeah,
we've just started.
But also because of social media, I think it's picking up, because social media have now, there are like social media companies and social media marketing and whatever, and they need. How I got into my job, basically.
Yeah. They need funny people around.
Yeah, they need funny people.
Yeah.
So even with just content, if you hire someone to write a caption for your page, they'd rather have someone who's witty, who can write like maybe a joke about the product or whatever. So funny people have always been in demand, and they'll just be in more. Like social media is everything now. Every company that, most companies that don't do well on social media, they struggle. Like you have to have a presence.
Yeah.
No matter what you're doing. Yeah,
definitely, dude.
Yeah,
because that's a lot of places where, like, and also because social media is basically now their outreach program, right?
Yeah,
so they're either maintaining their audience that they've already created or finding new people.
Yeah,
and it's only happening through social media, especially now that the pandemic is happening. How else do you reach your customer?
And more and more people get on social media every day, especially in India. Dude, today I went out to pick up some stuff, and this man, probably he looked like he was an electrician or something, just he's sitting and he's easily in his 50s and he's watching reels, bro. So imagine, it's like going that, like if you have free time, you're sitting and watching reels. I could hear the trending music playing on. So like you're reaching just every corner, and every day just more people and more people.
Exactly,
more people.
And even the digital literacy in India is also increasing, right? Like people are now understanding that, okay, a phone is a thing, right? Like which almost everybody can own, right? It's cheaper to get a phone, cheaper to have an internet connection.
You don't need a TV anymore.
You don't need exactly. That's what.
Jio came in with free internet. Think of how many people got on the internet just because of that.
It's like all of your gadgets are like combining into one.
And the algorithm is actually so good that it will find you, your audience. Like when I see my mom go through her reels, like they're in my native language. Like the algorithm has recognized that she watches content which is in Farsi. It was so weird for me. I was like, why are your reels in a different language? But then it finds exactly what you like. Like, why are there table tennis videos in my reels? Because I fucking enjoy watching table tennis videos. I don't play it ever, but like if there's a table tennis video, I'll watch it. If there's a snooker video, I'll watch it.
I had
a whole fight with my algorithm, but I didn't like the stuff that it was showing me. So I did this thing. I love board games, so everybody knows about it. So I followed a lot of board game pages, and every time a board game post would come up, I would like it and dislike, like not like all of the other boards. like without even seeing, I would like it. So after a while, some board game things started.
Yeah, even with hashtags, if you look up a hashtag, it'll send you.
Yeah, it'll track it for you.
If you share something with a friend, they'll like, if it's from a specific creator, then that creator stuff will come in your reels. So it works very well.
This happens a lot with Twitter also. Twitter though, you get it left, right and center. You've not subscribed to that person, you've not followed them, but like you'd find them.
And it's stuff that you'll actually like most of the times.
Yeah, which is kind of creepy also. But
But then my problem, I've never had a problem with targeted ads. I'm like, Yeah, it's good. Like, I'd rather see something that I may be interested
in. See, I work in tech, okay, so I can't say anything about this because I'm part of the problem.
Yeah, but then it's smart, right? You're reaching the people that you want to reach. True. Instead of just throwing it out there for a bunch of people who probably won't be into it.
That is there. Plus, I also feel is that now that slowly with platforms like YouTube and stuff pushing and gunning for like people to take subscriptions, right? After one point in time, you won't need target ads.
Yeah.
I know that's a time which is way far off into the future.
Yeah.
But that's the whole concept, right? You don't need to be shown an ad if you're paying for the service.
Yeah.
So I think there will come a time where targeted ads won't be a thing anymore. There will be something else. Yeah, that's what. They will morph into something, some other form.
It's already happening, no? Like with influencer marketing.
Right. But influencer marketing was always there, don't you think? Yeah.
I work for this type of stuff and I just sometimes don't get it. The audience doesn't like it. The thing is that now that TV ads have become such like, it's so boring.
They've just become premises.
Yeah, they've become premises. Now they want to do a video, but not like be just, I understand when it's like, you start a video, but like this video is sponsored by this, blah, blah, blah. We come back to the video. But now they want a video around that brand, which is also funny and all that type of stuff. Yeah. And then have the brand also. It just like which becomes boring videos.
Yeah, we are trying so hard to.
The audience gets it. Like there are a lot of comments saying that why did I watch a 13-minute ad?
Yeah, but if you know your audience well and you know what to push to them, then they'll actually enjoy watching that ad.
Yeah,
they'll be like, yeah, this is actually something that. But what happens is with influencers, they start getting offers and it's good money, so they're like, why should I turn it down? And then ad doesn't do well. Sure. So it's still very fresh, but then now people will start realizing ki this ad isn't going to convert much because this person has nothing to do with this. Yeah. This audience will have nothing to do with this. If you know the influencer well, there's so much that you can do.
Yeah,
but definitely. No, why do comics need to promote face wash? Like for what?
I saw one, I think Kenny had done one, I think a Fevikwik ad. He did a nice one. It was a neat 15-second
reel. Yeah, a lot of comics pull it off really well.
Yeah.
Shreeja does like a really good.
Yeah. So like there are some people who really play it off well,
brand
right?
Work.
They do some proper writing around it or conceptualization around it in whatever level that they do it.
Yeah.
But some people are just like, hey guys, khareed lo.
Yeah.
And then music.
And like you're doing an ad for Gillette, everyone buys Gillette already. Like I didn't need this comic to come and tell me to use that. What's my other option?
Remember, so Zomato had done this
thing where there's
competition where you had to make an ad for them. So we had also made an ad because of the hype.
Yeah.
Okay, we were like, our YouTube channel will get So we had made an ad and we spent like almost 2 weeks making the ad.
No, what? We'd finished it in 3 days.
But like conceptual, but okay, 3 days we finished it in.
Yeah.
None of us uses Zomato.
Yeah, dude, I see you swinging.
But they were dropping good money for that. They were like, oh, how? 25 lakhs or something?
No, one lakh.
I don't know how much.
Big prize money, I remember.
But, I mean, they got the amount of money that they were offering for as prize. They got marketing done for way more than that.
Yeah,
in
it was
free.
My fear is just like, everyone, Zomato.
People, like, I still remember when we put the video out, there was still like a day and 2 days left or 1 day left. And 2-3 of my friends were like, oh, you put a video, so I'm just gonna go ahead and do it myself also. So he picked up, one person picked up his brother, somebody picked up somebody else. Now they're making their own videos. And like that, it just branched out.
Yeah. Let's talk about sketch comedy and wrap this up because I think it's been... You guys do sketches, no? Like how do you guys enjoy making them or is it just... Like, we should be making sketches.
No, I love making sketches.
I
love making sketches. Because you have a larger span of time to tell a bigger story.
Yeah.
It's a bit hard to shift from comedy writing to sketch writing because sketch is more about characters and comedy is more about the words that you're saying.
There used to be, sketch comedy was really big at one point. Now it's thoda, like, who's doing sketch comedy and is doing a really good job. That, this guy, Shane Gillis or someone, he has a YouTube channel.
Okay.
This guy who was, he got on Saturday Night Live,
mm-hmm.
and then he got cancelled like 5 days after.
Okay.
Because someone pulled an old podcast clip. But mm-hmm. now he's doing like a proper high production YouTube channel.
Mm-hmm.
And he has no boundaries, right? He can say whatever he wants. So
yeah.
he's done a lot of fun shit. He did like an OnlyFans dad. OnlyFans.
Oh, wait, are you talking about shirtless?
No, no.
Okay.
I don't know. Shane Gillis, I think his
okay.
name is. And like he did one, like he was dressed up as Trump and he was speed dating. So.
Okay.
So that's one I really enjoy. I don't know if you guys have any that you watch right now.
Oh, yeah. So currently, I very recently got into Churdlis. I don't know if you guys know about it. So they.
Churdlis.
Yeah. I think I sent you that video also.
Oh, yeah.
So they have a very millennial vibe.
Yeah.
Their camera work is very shit. Like
yeah.
very mockumentary-ish.
Yeah.
And they're playing mainly on the character and their tropes and their stereotypes.
Mm.
So they have some nice, like, the scene doesn't always go somewhere.
Yeah.
But it's fun to watch.
Yeah.
Right?
Is it like kind of awkward and...
Yeah. Yeah.
yeah.
yeah. They have this whole fuckboy character, mm. right? So they're like...
yeah.
Say, if I come out to your office. right? So the way they play their characters, right? That's something very fascinating.
Yeah.
Right? Because they... pick up certain aspects and they just blow it up.
Yeah.
So that's just like a lot of inspiration also to, you know, just pick one problem in something and just blow it up.
I love sketches that are like that. Like there is this show called Wellington Paranormal. It's my favorite show. It has a lot of like, I remember one conversation was just like, have you ever found the one? Yeah, I've had many. So just play on it. Okay?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Like, you've had more than one once? Yeah, I'm one of the lucky people to have about 4 to 5. And that's the whole scene.
Yeah,
they just
yeah,
scratch
yeah.
it out as much.
Yeah.
And what we also realized after writing sketches was that a lot of shows, movies that you see are just a bunch of sketches put together.
Hmm. Yeah.
Yeah. It's
comedy
just one sketch
maybe,
to another.
Yeah.
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 That's what it is.
Yeah. Have you guys realized it's kind of impossible to make comedy films anymore? Like films that will be as funny as they used to be. Because
like, what are you comparing it with?
Bollywood, I don't know. But like, something like Superbad or Step
mm-hmm.
Brothers.
Oh, yeah.
mm-hmm.
A shit like that, you can't make them anymore because it's just going to piss people off.
Yeah.
Or how do you write comedy now for movies or for sitcoms? Like, The Office, they can't put out The Office today because of a lot of the stuff that they say.
I mean, they did make the Indian version
so
of
bad.
Office. I still remember there was a line in that, like, where Steve
yeah.
Indian Steve is
yeah.
talking to Indian Pam. And the Indian Pam is called Parminder. Pammi is basically, that's the pet name, okay? So he
yeah,
goes up
put
to...
Put no thought into it. Like, Pam, Pammi, write it down, highlight
yeah.
it with the marker.
Well, that show could have been good if they would have taken the concept, make their own characters, did an and put an Indian spin to it. Not
yeah.
take exact lines, translate
yeah.
them.
Yeah.
That's
yeah.
how the UK office was and then the US office was good.
Yeah.
And then there could have been an Indian office.
Yeah.
But carry on. What are you saying?
But yeah, the thing is, I don't think that there is a problem in making a comedy film or a movie or something. That you'll always get it.
Mm.
It's just that it will be a different. You won't ever have a Superbad again.
Yeah.
You'll have something else.
Yeah.
Right? Like, it's like how you had a Dil Chahta Hai then. You can never have a Dil Chahta Hai again.
Yeah.
You'll have something else in its place.
But what was the last funny film that you watched?
Last funny film.
What We Do in the Shadows.
Oh.
Have you seen that
No.
film?
Is,
oh,
yeah.
It's a vampire mockumentary
okay.
about what vampires do when they're not out sucking blood. They're just normal vampire chores and stuff. It's a beautiful movie.
Yeah.
I'll watch it.
Yeah, that's the same one. I watched
yeah.
that one. There was another one. It's not really a comedy. It's a mockumentary. I had told you to watch it. You couldn't get through the end.
Oh.
The Dog Bites Man. It's a very dark movie.
Yeah.
It's a mockumentary. It's made by... It's a French film. It's about this camera crew who's trying to follow a serial killer.
Yeah.
So it starts in a very comedic way, but it gets too dark.
It was very good, but I couldn't get through it.
It was, but yeah.
Well,
was,
Europe has always been super free. You know? Like, we'll talk about anything. We'll like European films, even like Spanish films. They've always been wild. There's no cancel culture over there.
Mm-hmm.
It's just that Hollywood is super left now. I think the only Kevin Hart is still he'll make you laugh, like no matter what he does. Like you're bound to laugh at the shit he says. Other than that, I don't remember the last time I watched a good
The other day I was watching Dave. Have you all watched Dave?
Yeah.
No, it's a show by Lil Dicky. He's a rapper.
Oh, I know Lil Dicky, yes.
Yeah. So that's a funny show.
Yeah. Dave is quite funny.
And it's not done by a comic.
Yeah. But Dave is thoda. Like, he's like, even his music is comedy, a lot of it.
Lot of it is, right? Yeah. But that's the thing, right? Now, you will find it in different places. There will be different ways in which people will get you to laugh, right? Whether it be in a rap song, the way Lil Dicky makes it, whether it be in a TV show, whether it be a podcast, right? So
that's exactly why a lot of people have turned to podcasts.
Mm-hmm.
They're like, TV is not as fun.
Mm-hmm.
Like, it's not as funny. Then a podcast, there's not much filters. You say whatever you want.
Yeah.
So,
it's a bit more natural also. You know, you don't have to be like, so guys.
Like, you sit and watch, I don't know, Flagrant 2. And just, they take something, make jokes about it for 15 minutes, move to the next topic. Make jokes about, and that's as good as a sitcom. Like, I'm laughing while I'm watching them.
Yeah. It's banter, that's what they're doing, right?
Yeah. At it's the natural, end of it's like friends having a good time chilling.
Yeah, that was a concert of Friends also, right? When Friends came out, it was showing banter between friends.
Yeah.
Right? If you see, if you deconstruct any of the scenes, it is banter.
Yeah.
They've taken, okay, he's had a breakup and now they're making jokes about it.
Yeah.
Right? So that's, I think that formula has this now that you can do that as a podcast, you can do that as a song. Whichever way you can modulate that formula works.
Yeah. So, guys, if you want to write comedy, just get two friends and roast each other.
I love roasting.
I suck at roasting.
I love roasting.
Roasting is, if especially with friends, when you know...
Oh, yeah.
When you know secrets, when you know insecurity.
It feels warm inside, you know, when you're like...
Yeah, but that's how we... Like, as guys, that's how we show each other.
You're
my friend, I love you.
That's a very male problem.
I'm gonna make fun of you, and this is how I'm showing you I love you.
Yeah.
And that's, like, great. That's the best way you can show someone. It's like, I'm gonna let you say all these horrible things about me. Because I love you.
Sounds like a toxic relationship.
Toxic. But,
I had a girl on the podcast before this, and we spoke about this. And she's like, we don't have that.
They don't. I've seen girls are the most optimistic people about each other.
It's kind of sweet. They're like, fuck, when I post a picture, I want my guy friends to be like,
I want somebody to hype me in my comments, like, fire. Everybody's just writing chutia. Like, what is this?
Sometimes my comments are like, phone kar.
And then she talked about how it's because we've been always pitted against each other in school, and it's like in school it's always a competition, and like our teachers, they make sure that we are quiet and introverted. As if there's a girl who's super chatty and is making jokes, the teacher is like, what the fuck is wrong with you? Behave like a girl. And for us, if we say something funny, everyone laughs. All the girls in the class always laugh. The teacher also sometimes, you know, they like you for being that guy who,
the class clown who disrupts class. True.
So that's, she said this is the reason.
Yeah.
But then they get super insecure if someone makes a joke about something. Like, how can you say that? Like, in front of everyone else.
I have a lot of friends who, like, women who love jokes.
Yeah.
You know, they can take a joke.
Yeah.
And that's great. And so the other part of this over-enthusiastic, optimism is... This is the counter opposite that I have seen, is that they will be very nice to each other.
Mm.
And then they'll go back home and they'll be like, you know what she was wearing?
I think it's like a overlap. It's a meta almost, because they can't be rude to each other now.
So they do it in the private.
Suppress the suppressed. And then they go back and then they...
Yeah.
And then you have to listen to it. And if you don't play along, you're fucked. You're like, that bitch.
No, I just started canning them. The minute I see hypocrisy, I'm like, you don't talk. You cannot hype that person and then bitch to me. about this person.
No, I'm gonna bitch, bro.
After saying that, sure. But
I'm just gonna play along and be like, Because I've realized girls, no, sometimes when they're telling you about a problem, they're not asking for a solution.
Mm.
They just want you to be like, yeah.
I think it's a lot of people, it's not just women specific.
Yeah, but it's fun to generalize.
Yeah.
It's not fun otherwise. Okay, guys, this has gone on for way longer than I thought.
How long has it gone on for?
You guys got here at like 6:30.
Dang, 2 hours.
Oh, damn.
Yeah. I'll cut it up a little here and there.
Sorted.
So, this was super fun. This is the first time I'm speaking to you guys. And
we met once before.
Yeah, but we never like had a conversation.
Yeah, we've never.
Yeah. Yeah. Guys, check their workout. I'll put your Instagrams below. And once show start, please come.
Yes.
And attend shows. They're super fun. Like, you'll want to go again and again.
Yes.
And if you're at home doing nothing, watch Zoom shows. They're fun.
Debatable.
Subscribe to our YouTube channel.
Done. Sick.
Nice one.
Nice.